Hello students, welcome to today's class. Today we'll be dealing with an important topic, that is the classification of mental disorders. And in this process of classification, we'll also be understanding two important systems of classification, that is the DSM and the ICD. To begin with, like in any other behavioral science, classification is extremely important in the field of abnormal psychology as well, to understand, define, and separate different categories of maladaptive behavior. Any process of understanding the nature, the causes, and the treatments of any kind of mental disorders should begin with classification. For instance, if we want to know what are the causes or treatments or nature of sleep disorders, for instance, or eating disorders, first we must know what kind of behaviors are included in sleep disorders, or how can we define eating disorders. And this kind of definition is provided by a system of classification. Classification is also important because at the primary level, psychologists, like any other professionals, require a nomenclature or a naming system or something in the sense of a common vocabulary to talk about their field, so that there is some kind of systematization and organization in the kind of diagnostic terms used. Otherwise, there will be a lot of confusion. One psychologist will be referring to schizophrenia as depression, another will be referring to same symptoms as mania, and so on. Also assist some other processes. For instance, we need to know the prevalence of various disorders in the population. Similarly, we need to know as to which populations are more vulnerable to certain disorders, or in which populations certain disorders can occur more frequently. Now, all of these research firstly depends on understanding and labeling and defining what that particular disorder is. Also, when we define mental disorders and we define certain behaviors as comprising mental disorders, it also helps the psychologist to define for himself what is the range of his profession. If he knows that certain behaviors are included as maladaptive behaviors or are a part of mental disorders, he can know, yes, as a part of my profession, I need to deal with these behaviors. They come under the purview of my profession. Finally, diagnostic classification is also needed at a more practical level, because psychology doesn't exist in a vacuum in the society. It has several relations with other societal institutions. For instance, you have a school and you need funding for a special education program. Immediately, you will have to give them the number of mentally retarded students or autistic students. Without diagnosis, how will you find out how many students are mentally retarded or how many students are autistic? So diagnosis and classification is required. Similarly, insurance companies, whenever you go in for insurance or medical claims for treatments incurred on mental disorders, they will ask for formal specific diagnosis. Unless a classification and diagnostic system is there, you cannot claim for such kind of reimbursement. The usefulness of any system of classification is based on two factors. This diagnostic system is reliable and the diagnostic system is valid. Reliability indicates that different observers or different researchers or different examiners will look at the same behavior and diagnose it in the same category of mental disorders. If this kind of decisions vary from one observer to another observer, we can say that the system of classification is not clear enough or precise enough, and hence is not reliable. Validity means that once we diagnose a person's behavior as falling into some category of mental disorder, we should be able to predict to some degree his future behavior and the future course of the disorder. If this is not possible, then the system is not measuring what it seeks to measure and hence is not valid. Now, many people criticize that using a process of diagnosis would be going back into the biomedical model and seeing mental illness as simply a disease having biological causes. But at the same time, it is necessary to remember that diagnostic systems have a great importance in actual day-to-day life situations, and hence more and more researchers are following diagnostic systems such as the DSM and the ICD. Firstly, we will be seeing a diagnostic system called the International Classification of Diseases, or the ICD. Now, the International Classification of Diseases, or the ICD, is the world's standard tool to capture data on mortality and morbidity. Mortality, as you know, is the rate of people dying because of a particular disease, whereas morbidity refers to the number of people affected by a particular disease. Now, the ICD organizes and codes a number of health information and disease information that can be used for a number of purposes, such as statistics, understanding the prevalence of disorders or epidemiology, for healthcare management, for the allocation of health resources, for monitoring, evaluation, research, treatment, and prevention. So you can see there are a host of activities that depend upon the data provided by the ICD. Now, the ICD is used by a variety of professionals, including physicians, nurses, other providers of healthcare, researchers, managers, information technology personnels, public health workers, policymakers, insurance organizations, and even patients and patient organizations themselves. So you can see the host of people who are involved in using the ICD. Now, 70% of the allocation of healthcare resources in the world depends upon the data on mortality and morbidity provided by the ICD. It is on the basis of this data as to which populations are most affected and where funds should go most that resource allocations are made. The main function that the International Classification of Diseases does is that it provides a common language to various healthcare practitioners, a common language in which they can talk about diseases and disorders. Hence, information can be stored in a standard way, and also it can be exchanged between hospitals and hospitals, between states and states, regions and regions, countries and countries. And hence, an entire picture of disease and disorder in the world can be obtained easily. Now, if we briefly go over the history of the International Classification of Diseases, we will see that it developed mainly from the international list of the causes of death put forward by a French physician, Jacques Bertillon. And later, this was adopted by the International Statistical Institute in 1893. Now, this classification system was based on classifying general disorders from disorders or diseases that involved only particular organs or organ systems. Later, a number of revisions were conducted, and there was a synthesis or an amalgamation of English, Swiss, and German versions, and the list increased from 44 titles to 161 titles or classifications. In the year 1898, the American Public Health Association recommended that the states of Canada, Mexico, and the United States also adopt this system of classification, and it also recommended that this system of classification should be revised every 10 years. Later, of course, it was found that this was too small a period, but the ICD has been revised periodically so as to reflect current research and current progress in medical science. Now, when the WHO, the World Health Organization, was created in the year 1948, the responsibility of publishing and handling the International Classification of Diseases, or the ICD, was handed over to the WHO. The first version of the ICD under the WHO was the ICD-6. Later, subsequent revisions have taken place, and the version of the ICD that we currently use is the ICD-10. It was developed in May 1990 and came into use in the year 1994. Now, one important information is that the ICD has been classified into 43 languages, so you can see how widely it is used. And the WHO nomenclature requires that all the countries or members of the WHO use the most current version of the classification system, that is ICD-10 for now. Now, the ICD-11 is also being expected to be out by 2015, and the people in charge of this revision are taking a very innovative approach. In fact, they are asking medical practitioners and healthcare professionals from all fields to put forward their views on the revision through a web-based portal so that a maximum broad-based analysis of all current research can be made and included in the next version. Now, mental disorders along with physical disorders also find separate codings within the ICD. Now we come to the second classification system, that is the Diagnostic or Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, the DSM. In the late 19th century, Emil Kraepelin developed the first most comprehensive and organized system of classification, and later a number of classification systems emerged which followed this system of classification. And in the year 1952, the American Psychological Association put forward its own system of classification in the form of the DSM. Now, like the ICD, the DSM is also very widely used by a number of clinical professionals. For instance, researchers, clinicians, psychiatric drug agencies, health insurance companies, pharmaceutical companies, psychiatrists, psychologists, and even patient organizations. Now, since its inception in 1952, the DSM has undergone a number of revisions. Some disorders have been removed, other disorders have been added, and in general, the total number of disorders has increased. Efforts have also been made to match the DSM codes with the ICD codes, and these efforts have succeeded also to some extent, although a total synchrony or a one-to-one synchrony may not be found. Now, the first DSM put forward by the APA in 1952 was referred to as the DSM-1. And the main feature of the DSM was that it had emerged from research in military medicine. And the DSM-1 was mainly an effort to standardize the diagnostic procedures being used by military personnel during the Second World War. And the first DSM consisted of 106 mental disorders and was 130 pages long. Now we come to the DSM-2, or the revision of the first DSM that happened in 1968. Now the DSM-2 tried to reflect the large amount of research that had happened after the Second World War, especially because research in psychological areas was funded and encouraged by the federal government, which wanted to analyze the ill effects or the psychological troubles that the war had caused. Now the DSM-2 was of course longer than the DSM-1. It consisted of 182 disorders and was 134 pages long. Soon, however, psychologists realized that both the DSM-1 and the DSM-2 were ineffective to a large extent. For instance, the reliability was very low, the terms used were vague, too descriptive, too jargon-laden, and the possibility was there that two or more researchers looking at the same behavior would diagnose it in different ways. And hence, due to this lack of reliability, an effort was made to put forward another revision of the DSM in the form of DSM-3. Now, in 1974, a decision was made to revise the DSM-2, and the chairmanship of the committee to revise this manual was handed over to Robert Spitzer. Now, the DSM-3 had remarkable changes as compared to DSM-2 and is seen as the single most influential document and breakthrough in diagnostic classifications. Now, what the DSM-3 did was to tackle the problems of reliability and validity. This it did by removing all those kind of vague descriptions of disorders and defining disorders in a very operational way, so that the exact systems of signs and symptoms for each disorder would be put forward. And secondly, it would also be put forward as to what particular signs and symptoms need to be met for the person to be classified as having the disorder. A second thing that the DSM-3 did was to introduce a multi-axial system in which the individual would be measured or classified on a variety of axes so as to get a more broad and comprehensive picture of his mental condition rather than concentrating only on single dimensions. Finally, when the revised version in the form of DSM-3 was published, it was 494 pages long and had 265 diagnostic categories. Later, however, the chairman of this very committee, Spitzer, criticized his own work, saying that this big increase in the number of disorders might have been due to an increased medicalization. He felt that almost 20 to 30% of the newly added disorders were actually normal behavior, which were now seen as abnormal due to the increasing medical research and due to over-precise classification. Now, the DSM-3R, or the revision of the DSM-3 put forward in 1987, also more or less followed the same pattern as the DSM-3. Now, the next revision of the DSM, that is the DSM-4, was published in 1994, and it listed 297 disorders and consists of a mammoth 886 pages. Now, one major factor we need to understand while we talk about DSM-4 is that it was in this DSM that for the first time the clinically significant criteria was used. It was put forward that it is not just enough that the signs and symptoms the person shows meets the criteria for diagnosis, but it should also be necessary that the person's behavior produces clinically significant distress to him or others in social, occupational, work, and other settings. Now we come to the version of the DSM we are currently using, that is the DSM-4-TR, which was published in 2000. Now the DSM-4-TR, as is the DSM-4, is based on a lot of research. The people in charge of the revision have made considerable effort to actually incorporate as many research studies as possible in the process of diagnosing disorders within the DSM-4-TR. Now, in its definition of disorders, the DSM-4-TR tries to be atheoretical. Atheoretical in the sense that it does not refer to any kind of causation of mental disorders. It simply describes the disorder. Point number two, it rules out behaviors which are culturally significant or which are normal. For instance, grief after the death of a person close to you. Such disorders are not to be included as mental disorders. This is specified by the DSM. Finally, the DSM also specifies that disorders are a result of dysfunctions, and dysfunctions relate to the individual, not groups of individuals. Now we will be going over briefly over the major characteristics of the DSM-4-TR. The first characteristic is specific diagnostic criteria. Now the DSM-4-TR specifies essential diagnostic criteria, for instance, in terms of the essential features of the disorder that define it, associated features of the disorder that may be present, and on the basis of these essential features and associated features, it puts forward a list of signs and symptoms that must be present essentially for the person to be diagnosed as having the disorder. In addition, it also gives information on differential diagnosis or how that particular mental disorder differs from other similar disorders. A lot of other information is also given, for instance, the age of onset of the disorder, the degree of impairment, complications, predisposing factors, familial patterns, prevalence patterns, findings of physical exam, relationship of the disorder to factors such as age and gender, and so on. A second important feature of the DSM-4-TR is the introduction of the multi-axial system. The multi-axial system requires that when the diagnostician is actually classifying the person, he should put out a small picture of the mental functioning of the person rather than focusing on one isolated disorder or the other. So the DSM-4-TR puts forward five axes. Axis 1 consists of the clinical syndrome or the main disorder or psychological problem for which the individual is being diagnosed or classified. Now, Axis 2 consists of personality disorders and mental retardation. That is any accompanying long-term disorder in addition to the Axis 1 diagnosis. The third is Axis 3 disorder, which involves general medical conditions or general medical conditions or physiological disorders which are caused by or are related to or influenced by the mental disorder. The fourth axis involves possible psychosocial and environmental causation for the development of the disorder and as consequences of the disorder. Finally, we have the axis 5, where the diagnostician makes an assessment of the global functioning and adjustment of the individual across a number of areas. For instance, work performance, social relationships, use of leisure time, and so on. Currently, as also in the past 1 year. And on the basis of that, a GAF score or the Global Assessment Functioning score ranging between 1 to 100 is given to the person. A final important feature of the DSM-IV is unspecified cause. As I have mentioned earlier, the DSM is atheoretical. It does not mention any cause for the particular disorders or any causation views. What it does is simply describe the disorder as specifically as possible. Because the removal of causal factors portrays psychology as weak as compared to other sciences. But this is necessary for the DSM because if it puts forward any causal views, it may create a number of problems in psychologists because, as we know, in psychology as a behavioral science, there are a number of viewpoints and perspectives. And psychologists also hold number of viewpoints and perspectives. So causation, if belonging to any particular perspective, may create problems in usage by psychologists following another perspective. So safely, what the DSM does is to totally avoid any kind of speculation regarding causation. Now, the most recent revision of the DSM is the DSM-5, which was published in May 2013, and yet it has not come into full use because research and validation processes are still on. Now, there are certain significant changes in the DSM-5 as compared to the DSM-4. First is that the multi-axial system has been totally scrapped. Axis 1, Axis 2, Axis 3 are now together listed as disorders in Section 2. Axis 4 is replaced with significant psychosocial and contextual features, and if we remember, the Axis 5 of global assessment functioning has also been dropped. In addition, there are a number of minor changes. For instance, mental retardation has a new name, that is intellectual disability or intellectual development disorder. Similarly, skin picking disorder or excoriation or hoarding disorder is now included in obsessive compulsive disorders. Similarly, pica and rumination disorders, which were till now disorders of infancy or childhood, are now applicable to all age groups of people, including adults and old age. And so there are certain minor changes, and still questions are being raised regarding the validity and reliability of the DSM. As time progresses and as further research comes forward regarding the DSM-5, then we will be able to get a more clear understanding of what it holds for diagnostic classification of psychopathology. Now, any system of diagnostic classification has been widely criticized by a number of researchers. We will go over briefly over some criticisms which are seen as most influential. The first criticism is that any system of diagnosis puts forward a falsification of reality or falsifies what is real. For instance, researchers believe that the classification of behavior or the diagnosis of behavior as normal or abnormal gives the impression that abnormal behavior is qualitatively different from normal behavior. Whereas in reality, normal and abnormal behavior lie on the same continuum. It is only a difference of quantity rather than quality. For instance, the DSM-IV-TR defines nightmare disorders as nightmares that are extended and very frightening. Now, for instance, there may be two people who are suffering from one person's nightmares may not fit the criteria for DSM diagnosis, but another person's nightmares may fit the criteria. But just because one person's diagnosis fits the criteria, his nightmares are seen as abnormal, whereas the other person's nightmares are normal. So you are qualitatively defining behavior as being totally different. A second criticism of diagnosis is that diagnosis gives a sense of artificial clarity, or just because we classify maladaptive behaviors into different groups of disorders, it gives a sense of clarity that these disorders do not overlap. On the other hand, we can see that the same maladaptive behaviors may be seen in people suffering from manic depressive disorders or schizophrenia or anxiety disorders. Hence, this classification is not as clear-cut as it seems to be when you read a classification system. A third criticism is that diagnosis puts forward an illusion of explanation. Now, certain diagnostic criteria, say for example schizophrenia, now, certain diagnostic terms, say for instance schizophrenia or manic depression or anxiety disorders, are not only used as diagnostic terms but are often also used as explanatory terms. For instance, we often say that she has hallucinations and delusions because she is having schizophrenia. Now, this is almost like saying that she has schizophrenia because she has schizophrenia. Because hallucinations and delusions are not caused by schizophrenia. Hallucinations, delusions, and other behaviors are together given a common name, that is schizophrenia, whereas the cause for schizophrenia is something different. But often when we give certain labels, we often feel that causation is also explained, and this assumption is extremely wrong. Now, one major criticism of diagnosis is that it leads to labeling, stereotyping, and stigma. Researchers argue that once a person is diagnosed with a disorder, then the physicians, doctors, and other people focus on the disorder and not the individual. The disorder becomes the focus and the definition of the entire individual. And such kind of diagnostic labeling can lead to a lot of stigma and stereotyping. Once a person receives a diagnosis of a disorder, it is kind of a certification that he has a mental illness, and it may create a lot of problems in occupational and social rehabilitation and in the maintenance of personal relationships. Often, when the individual does not succeed in rehabilitating himself into the normal society, he may adopt the sick role and continue to be a mental patient all throughout his life. Another major criticism raised is that diagnostic systems such as the DSM arbitrarily divide people into abnormal and normal depending upon arbitrary cutoffs. For instance, two persons may be facing the same level of mental distress, but one is seen as abnormal and the other normal just because they do not satisfy some particular criteria of DSM diagnosis. Hence, they have recommended a dimensional classification where instead of giving a single classification, say for example manic depressive disorder, the person would be given a score on a number of dimensions, say for example anxiety, sleep disturbance and so on, and other such components of the disorder. Another major criticism raised is the cultural bias. Researchers strongly criticize that the entire diagnostic system is based on a Euro-American outlook towards maladaptive behavior, and it does not give proper recognition to a number of cultural factors. Efforts have been made to include cultural considerations within the DSM. For instance, the DSM now has culture-bound syndromes as a section. But again, researchers like Arthur Kleinman say that the very term culture-bound syndromes indicate that cultural sensitivity isn't there. This is because syndromes from other cultures are seen as culture-bound, whereas syndromes which have been defined on the basis of an American outlook have been seen as normal. A final criticism is the medicalization and conflict of interests. Many researchers feel that the increasing number of disorders in the DSM, from 106 disorders in DSM-1 to 365 and more disorders in DSM-4-TR, is nothing but a medicalization of normal behavior. And this is done to suit the interests of drug companies, pharmaceutical companies, and other psychiatric agencies. However, researchers such as Spitzer and others say that this is not just because behavior which was seen as normal earlier is now seen as abnormal, or that we cannot tolerate even small differentiations in behavior. According to them, it is basically because our systems of classification have now become more precise and we can understand even small deviations between different disorders and different behaviors. Now, the critics of the DSM, while putting forward all the shortcomings of DSM and other diagnostic systems, put forward that the diagnostic system, in fact, must be totally abandoned. For instance, Rosenhan argues that unless a system of diagnosis proves that its merits can actually cover up the costs of diagnosis, such as labeling and stigma, only then should a diagnostic system be used. However, Spitzer and others argue back that unless we have some system of naming or diagnosis, we would never be able to go forward on understanding causation, nature, and treatment. We would have nothing to base our research on or start our research from. Finally, to conclude this chapter, let us understand some basic points regarding diagnostic classification. Firstly, although we have come a long way from the DSM-1 to the DSM-4-TR and from the ICD to the ICD-10 and 11, which is going to come in 2015, what should be remembered is that Diagnosis should involve cultural sensitivity. It should overcome deficits such as labeling, as also medicalization, and efforts should be made towards achieving these goals. Secondly, a diagnosis, whether it is from any source, should not be seen in itself. It should be seen along with other sources of information from the patient and from his socio-cultural backgrounds. Thirdly, what you have to remember is that a diagnosis classifies disorder. A diagnostic system never classifies individual, and the individual is not defined by the diagnosis of the disorder. And language is very important, whether you use it in your daily lives or whether other professionals use it. Usually, we often refer to a person as she is a schizophrenic or he is a manic depressive. The correct usage would be she is a person with schizophrenia or he is a person with manic depressive disorder. You cannot actually refer to the entire person in terms of the disorder. So the thing you should take back with you today in class is that although diagnosis is an important element and diagnostic systems are essential in our field, yet we should remember that the person is not the diagnosis. The person is different from the diagnosis.